Good morning.
Good morning, Hannah. Welcome to church this morning.
Good morning, beautiful people of Clarksville. We are so glad that you are here for worship this morning. Thank you for joining us. It is so good to be together. My name is Stephen, and I'm the pastor here at Hilldale United Methodist Church. It is my pleasure and honor to welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ to worship this morning. We want you to know that if you are new, we would love to know that you are here with us and joining us. Just comment new in the videos below, because we want to give a $5 donation to a charity of your choice here in our local community. So take a moment, let us know you're joining us, and we'll make a $5 donation in your name and follow up with you via email to get that selection. Also, whether you're new or not, we love that you comment and let us know you're here and catch up with your friends in the comments down below. So please take a moment to engage with each other and to keep our community connected and going. We really appreciate that you do that. We do have a few announcements we want you to be aware of. Hannah is starting a Bible study, and you can contact her for more details or see the website of the Forgotten Women of the Book of Acts. And so that'll be starting up in the coming time. So take a moment to sign up for that if you would like to. We'd love for you to engage with that as well. Also, we've had several people ask us if they could buy our mask, our Hilldale UMC embroidered mask. And so we have those for sale. Those are on the website. And so you can check those out. If you've asked about getting one, now's your chance to get one. And so just take a moment to pre-order those. Go to HilldaleUMC.org and make sure that we take care of that. And lastly and not leastly, we are signing up for small groups, a way to connect starting after Labor Day. And so we've got more information again on the website. You can see the link below and go and check that out. But please take a moment to sign up. Let us know your interest. We're looking for wonderful ways for people to get together in person or virtually, or people are going to be meeting in both ways around hobbies and relationships that you already have. And so we're looking forward to you signing up and for us beginning those in the next few weeks to come. And on the front end of our service today, I just want to say a special thank you to our teachers, our administrators, our custodians, and everybody that's getting ready for the school year. We know that this has been incredibly difficult for you. We as parents in the community know it's been difficult for us, but we haven't had to do nearly as much as what you're having to do. We are so grateful for all the time and effort and energy. We know that this is incredibly stressful. We know you did not sign up for this, but we want you to know that we really appreciate you. And to the parents who are getting ready to send kids back, whether that's virtually or in person, we know this has been a difficult decision and time for you, and we're looking forward to getting into some routine, but it's gonna take a lot to get through this time right before school starts and when school starts. So we hope that this morning that you can connect with God, connect with each other, and remember that this too shall pass, and we will come to a place on the other side of this. And in the meantime, it's okay that we didn't sign up for this, but that God has something new planned for us as well. So let us continue in our worship service this morning. Amen.
Our song together this morning is Have Thine Own Way, Lord. So no matter what's going on, whatever sort of restoration that God is putting into us and upon us, we know that He loves us and He cares for us, and we will let Him have His way.
Mold me and make me after Thy.
as we go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Gracious God, we are so grateful to be in your presence this morning, that we are gathered together online to be in community with each other and with you. Lord, we know that in the midst of this sermon series, but also in the midst of our world, Lord, there is so much that we didn't sign up for. We know that there is anxiety, there is depression, there are feelings that of unrest in our world and in our hearts. God, we ask that you be with us, that you lead, guide, and direct us to continue to do your will in our worlds and our lives, and to impact our community in positive ways. Lord, we know that there are some things in our world that have happened that have been devastating. The hurricane that came through Texas and Louisiana, the damage that it created, and the unrest that those people have endured, God, please be with them. Lord, we also lift up to you our Clarksville, Montgomery County school system, the teachers, the administrators, the staff, and the students, God. Please be with all of them as they go back to what is not a normal, but a new normal. Help ease anxiety for them through this time of change. We also lift up to you, Lord, Melanie Mosier, and we extend our sympathies to her and her family in the death of her grandson. Please take this time now to lift up your personal petitions to our Lord. Lord, you have heard our prayers. Let us now join our voices together in the words of the prayer that you taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
As we come together in worship this morning, we bring to God our whole selves, and that includes our tithes and our offerings. We remind you this morning that we are a member-supported church, and as we come together during this time in our world, that the community support means more than ever for us to continue reaching our community, living our mission as a church, and continuing to help those in need in these places around us. So we appreciate your gifts of tithes and offerings as we seek to build God's kingdom here on earth right now. Let us pray. Lord, we are grateful for this day, for everything that you have given to us, that you have given us a place where we can come together, where we can be in person or through technology. We ask this morning that as we return our tithes and offerings to you, that you would bless both the giver as well as the recipient as we seek to build your kingdom. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, friends. I hope you have your stuffed animal with you today. Flame is joining me today. If you don't have it, go get it and restart the video when you're back with us. Today, I am not going to read the Bible story straight from the Bible. I hope that you have your children's church to-go box, and inside there, you'll read the Bible story, which is Mark chapter 4, verses 1 through 9, and then you'll do the science experiment that goes with it. Today, instead, I'm going to tell you a story. The story is about seeds. You know, seeds are amazing things. In each one, there's a miracle. There once was a seed, and in that seed was life. The seed was buried in the earth. In the dark, wet ground, it waited. It waited and waited. At the right time, the seed burst through its shell to search for the sun. In order to grow, the seed needed the sun. But something held it within the ground. If the seed could have seen up above, it would have seen a very heavy, moss-covered log lying on its birthplace. The seed could not live without light from the sun, but the log prevented it from growing tall and straight. The seed, feeling the life within, searched for another way to find the light. It searched and searched to the side instead of straight up, and finally found the light. Just like the seed, sometimes we have to adapt to change and turn a different direction and grow, but always growing towards the light that is Jesus. Will you pray with me today? Jesus, you are the light of the world. Help us to grow in your direction always. Amen.
Woke up this morning, life as you know it looks nothing like the kind of life you knew before. All of a sudden, fear stole the headlights, and it don't feel safe to even step outside your door. In this world, you will have trouble, but I have overcome the world. So take heart, take a breath, and let me lift that heavy weight up off your chest. Take my hand, I know it's looking dark, but when the world falls all around you, I won't let you fall apart. Take heart, take heart. Remember singing back when you were younger, he's got the whole world in his hands. Well, that's still true. See, I hold your family, all your friends, and all your loved ones, and even when you're barely holding on, I'm holding you. So take heart and take a breath, and let me lift that heavy weight up off your chest. Take my hand, I know it's looking dark, and when the world falls all around you, I won't let you fall apart. Take heart, yeah, but take heart. But I have overcome the world. Oh, in this world you will have trouble, but I have overcome the world. So take heart, take a breath, and let me lift that heavy weight up off your chest. Take my hand, I know it's looking dark, but when the world falls all around you, I won't let you fall apart. Take heart, oh child, take heart.
Well,
What do you do when it feels like everything has changed? We are diving into that very question here in the third week of our series called I Didn't Sign Up for This. And I'm going to recap a little bit of what we've gone over for the last couple of weeks to build up to this week. So the first week we said that God made change essential to life. That everything that is alive is growing, and if it stops growing, it dies or it stagnates and becomes unhealthy. And so that God has made this world something that ebbs and flows, that turns and revolves, that has light and dark, that has things that grow and thrive, as well as things that die and stop growing. And so that we wanted to learn how to embrace change in the midst of this. We started off with the first week saying, how do we change the way we think about change? So instead of looking at it as something negative and out of our control that we can do nothing good about and nothing good will ever come from, instead of seeing change in that light, we said, how can we begin thinking about change as an opportunity to take heart, as an opportunity to do what we can do to make this world a better place? And so we started by understanding how God made change essential to life as a beginning point for our changing our minds about how we think about change. And in the second week, we dove into the best way to deal with change is in the context of community. So we saw through blind Bartimaeus that when he had been healed, and even though it was a good change, he dealt with it by engaging in relationship with Jesus and with the people who followed Jesus. You see, when we go through changes in our life, we can feel like we're going through them all alone. Even in our time right now, in the midst of a pandemic, we have been talking to people, and most people have been feeling like they were going through this all on their own, even though people all around the world are going through and having the exact same problems. But because we have been so disconnected, so less engaged with each other, and it's been such a struggle to continue to communicate when we couldn't get together in person, we had begun to feel like we were in this all alone. And so last week we talked about how when we go through things like this, the best way to deal with change is in the context of community. That sometimes the only thing better than a map of how to get through something is somebody who's already been there and knows the way, and we join together with them. We had a plug for our small group ministry beginning in just a couple of weeks, and that's still available for you to sign up for right now on our website. We're signing up for small groups, gathering around things that we already like to do in our lives and finding ways to reorient ourselves, our whole lives, to who God is and what God is doing in this world, even in the midst of this time right here. And we're going to do that in the context of community, of caring, accountable relationship with one another, of getting to know new people and getting together with old friends at the same time. It's going to be a beautiful thing. The only way to deal with change is in the context of community. Now, we are moving into this third week, and there are things going on in this world that we know are difficult. Now, did you guys know, if you're joining us in the Clarksville, Tennessee area, you already know this, school starts back tomorrow. All the teachers right now, are you ready for school to start back tomorrow? Absolutely not. Nobody is. It doesn't matter if you're a student or a parent or a teacher or an administrator or a janitor. Everybody has done good work to get ready for tomorrow to go back to school, but none of us are ready. We've never done it this way before. We don't know what it's going to be like. If you're going to school virtually, what's it going to be like to attend classes through the computer with your students, with your kids? Maybe you've never homeschooled or taught your kids at home before. How are you going to do that? We're stressed out just even thinking about it. I know my family is stressed out getting the stuff ready to get together for school, getting the computers and the supplies and coordinating with teachers and mentors and taking the trainings and downloading the apps and getting everything together. It's been stressful. If you're going back to school and you're worried about whether your kid's going to be in a plexiglass little cube or whether they're going to have to wear their mask and will they be able to do it and what's it going to be like with fewer teachers and fewer students and how are they going to get there, the bus, or am I going to drive them and what's this all going to look like? And the teachers, oh my goodness, we've been hearing from teachers and they are the most stressed out I have ever heard of teachers being in my entire life. all of the extra trainings, all of the extra ways of teaching. You got to be online as well as in person. And this is true for our elementary and middle and high school, and also for Austin Peay and other universities in the area. We're having to learn new ways of doing things, and it, to be honest, is stressing us out. Administrators, whether you're at the district office or whether you're working in the schools, whatever it is, have had so many difficult decisions to make, difficult to communicate with everyone, and they can't make everyone happy. No matter what they do, someone is going to be upset. We are going through a difficult and stressful time, and I know that teachers have said, I didn't sign up for this. I know that parents have said, I didn't sign up for this. I know that my kids have said, I didn't sign up for this. And I can only imagine that administrators have said, I didn't sign up for this. So it begs the question, why are we doing it at all? If it is so stressful and there's not a good solution and nobody's going to like it and be happy about it, then why are we doing it at all? And when I ask that question, I know what you're thinking, Pastor, that's just an absolutely ludicrous question. Because of course we have to educate our children. Of course we have to help them learn how to socially be together and to be a part of a community and to care for one another and how to make this world a better place. We want their lives and this city and state and country and world to be a better place because of them. We have knowledge and values that we need to impart so that they can continue to move things forward in this world in a way that we want them to, in a way that God would even want them to. You see, we understand inherently that God doesn't want us to stop growing. When we think about going back and educating our children, it's never been a question of whether we were or were not going to educate our students, no matter their age. I don't think that was ever a question that anybody asked out loud. The question has been, how are we going to do it? We've always agreed on why. And perhaps we could start there in the midst of the debates and turmoil. We agree that our students need to be educated and socialized and that we care for them and that they are going to make this world a better place and that we are going to do everything we can do to help them do that. But how we do it has been up for debate, but never the why. Because you see, we understand inherently that they need to grow. They need to be educated. They need to progress for their quality of life and for the quality of life of everyone else in this world. It needs to happen. It must happen. God never wants them to stop growing. I'm here to tell you this morning as adults that God doesn't want us to stop growing either. That just because we've finished elementary or middle or high school or college or graduate school or our training for a specific job or whatever it may be, that doesn't mean that the growth of our life is over. Absolutely not. Just like our students, God never wants us to stop growing either. And so today we're going to dive into chapter 4 in Mark, where Jesus begins to tell some parables that help us see this and begin to apply this in our lives. And we're going to look in Mark chapter 4, and it's the parable of the soil. Now, I love this because some Bible translations will call it the parable of the seeds. But if you'll notice, it is about the seed, but the seed doesn't change. It's the soil that has to do something in order for the seed to do what the seed was meant to do. Mark chapter 4, verses 1 through 9. Jesus began to teach beside the lake again. Such a large crowd gathered that he climbed into a boat there on the lake. He sat in the boat while the whole crowd was nearby on the shore. He said many things to them in parables. Now, here's a question I'm going to posit right now, and we're going to get back to it in a little bit. Why did Jesus teach them in parables? Why didn't Jesus just say, it's like this? Because sometimes Jesus did, right? But Jesus teaches them in parables. Why does he do that? He said many things to them in parables. While teaching them, he said, listen to this. A farmer went out to scatter seed. As he was scattering seed, some fell on the path, and the birds came and ate it. Other seed fell on rocky ground where the soil was shallow. They sprouted immediately because the soil wasn't deep. When the sun came up, it scorched the plants and they dried up because they had no roots. Other seed fell among thorny plants. The thorny plants grew and choked the seeds and they produced nothing. Other seed fell into good soil and bore fruit. Upon growing and increasing, the seed produced in one case a yield of 30 to 1, in another case a yield of 60 to 1, and in another case a yield of 100 to 1. He said, whoever has ears to listen should pay attention. Now, what is Jesus trying to say here? Now, you and I, we have the benefit of having read the next part of this chapter that comes. Maybe if you've grown up in church, you've heard this story taught before. But if this was striking you for the first time, the questions would be, who is the farmer? If this was a reading example for one of our elementary school kids, it'd be, who is the farmer? Who are the birds? What is the seed? Where is this soil? What is the path and where is it going? What is the point of the story? What is the main theme? Why did Jesus teach them in parables of just setting, instead of just saying at first what he was meaning? You see, as we go to Mark chapter 4, verse 10, he has to explain because the people say when they were alone, the people around Jesus, along with the 12, asked him about the parables. They did not understand them. In verse 13, don't you understand this parable? Then how will you understand all the parables? You see, Jesus knew that they needed to think on it, that they needed to struggle with it, that they needed to outline it and diagram it and break it apart and begin to understand what it meant because it would last longer than just a simple instruction. He needed them to go through the process of growth when they would understand the stories that he taught. Jesus taught in parables so that us learning was actual work. Something that we would remember and grasp and have to work through. Lessons don't really stick when they're easy, do they? They stick when there's something difficult that we have to work through and get through and begin to understand and take apart and overcome. And those are the lessons in our life that we never forget. Because we had to grow. Because we had to change. Because we had to have courage and perseverance. And because we had to ultimately overcome. Come, and even in Jesus' teaching, Jesus insists that we grow just to understand what he is teaching. Jesus says, don't you understand this parable? Then how will you understand all the parables? The farmer scatters the word. This is the meaning of the seed that fell on the path. When the word is scattered and people hear it, right away Satan comes and steals the word that was planted in them. Here's the meaning of the seed that fell on the rocky ground. When people hear the word, they immediately receive it joyfully. Because they have no roots, they last for only a little while. When they experience distress or abuse because of the word, they immediately fall away. Others are like the seed scattered among the thorny plants. They are the ones who have heard the word, but the worries of this life, the false appeal of wealth and the desire for more things breaks in and chokes the word, and it bears no fruit. The seeds scattered on good soil are those who hear the word and embrace it. They bear fruit. In one case, a yield of 30 to 1. In another case, 60 to 1. And in another case, 100 to 1. This, my friends, is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So here we are hearing the word of God, beginning to understand what it looks like, and we are learning that we are the soil. That's why this is the parables of the soil. You see, I want you to realize there was nothing that the seed did in this. It was all up to the soil to absorb, to take in, to change, to be ready to have the seed planted in us. Are we ready to be the good soil? Because you see, the path didn't do anything wrong. It was just too hard. And the birds did what the birds naturally do. They swoop in and they take away what was left. The rocky soil, the seed is tossed on it. The seed didn't do anything wrong. There was just shallowness there and it couldn't take root because the soil wasn't ready. We think about the thorns, the worries of life, the things that get us down. It was all there waiting to choke out the good word when it landed with the people. And then we have the good soil. And this is what Jesus says again in verse 20. The seed scattered on good soil are those who hear the word and embrace it. And they bear fruit. You see, my friends, God never wants us to stop growing. We are to be preparing ourselves to be the good soil, not to be like the path or the rocky field that hasn't been prepared, not to get rid of the weeds and the thorns that will choke out this life. We have work to do before we even receive the word. But then once it has been done, we are to continue to help the seed grow, to have been prepared, to embrace the seed, and then we will bear fruit. You see, then the soil and the seed begin to merge together into one, and the work of the seed is also the work of the soil. And it says, they bear fruit. You see, if we think about a plant or a tree of any kind, when it bears fruit, it grows, it changes, it produces flowers and leaves and fruit. It does something. It cannot sit stagnant. It takes in what it is given, and it gives out something even greater than what it received, a yield of 30 to 1 or 60 to 1 or 100 to 1. My friends, growth is change. And our ability to grow depends on our ability to embrace change. You see, if we don't embrace the changes that are going around, that are going on around us, it doesn't mean we like them. We talked about this last week. It doesn't mean they're all good, but it means, do we trust that God can use us in the process of making good things come from the changes that are happening in our world? Now, my friends, especially you that are teachers, you are doing this work right now. You are going to be educating the people of our community, the children and students that are needing you to become the people that God created them to be. And there are a lot of changes. Are we going to be able to embrace them? Are we going to be able to find a way? Because we do not disagree that it should be done. It's only how it's going to be done. And it is difficult. You, my friends, are doing this work. You beautiful people of God, we commend you. It is hard work, but you are leading the way. You are showing us what it looks like to begin to embrace the changes, to take what is happening in this world that may or may not be good and to turn it into an opportunity for good for the innocent and the vulnerable and the children of our community. You are doing the work of God in this place. Embracing change so that children can continue to grow into who God has created them to be. What a wonderful mission, what a wonderful purpose, and what a wonderful example of what it means to have change happen around us, but to take it and reorient it all towards God and to say, what would you have me to do with this? Something must be done. How are we going to do it? And tomorrow we start doing it. And it's going to be hard. And it's going to be tedious. And there's going to be things that we didn't anticipate and we didn't expect. And we're going to have to adjust and to keep changing and to keep growing and to keep learning. But all for the good of the children of our community. For the souls that God has entrusted to us. When I was talking to some family this past week, I was encouraged by just thinking about this simple fact. Our ancestors made it this far, and they handed it to us. The people who came before you in your line, they made it through wars and plagues and famine. They made it through natural disasters. They made it through everything that this world could have possibly thrown at them. And here we are today because they survived, because they thrived, because they found a way to make good in the midst of change and to make it work for them and their children who would one day come and their grandchildren and their great-grandchildren and so forth and so on until we got here today. What they have been through, what they went through, did not break them. And it will not break us. We are a people who can change. We are a people who can grow. We are the people of God, the good soil who makes itself ready for God to do a new thing in this community through us and with us. We will learn from it. We will learn through it. And we will thrive in spite of it. Because God is constant yesterday, today, and forever. And even when we have to figure out new ways of doing and being in this world, God is right there with us, helping us, staying with us. And in the midst of a time such like this, we are being called to learn, to grow, to change, so that we can continue standing strong on who God is to make this world from the way that it is right now into the way that it always should have been. What an amazing thing. My friends who are teachers, we are praying for you, for parents who have had to make hard decisions, and for those who have already started school back in the different school systems and schools in the area, we are praying for you. You are doing good work, and you are modeling what it means to understand that the why has never been in question, just how we're going to get there. And it's required some change, but it's worth it because we can see the kingdom of God ahead of us. Let us pray. Lord, we are amazed that you continue to work in this world, and we are so grateful that you do. Lord, sometimes things just seem overwhelming. They seem like we don't know what we could possibly be doing, and we just want to run and to hide. But we hear your voice calling us out of our own selfishness, out of the worries like thorns that choke away the life and the mission and the purpose that you have for us. Lord, don't make our hearts hardened to where we won't hear your voice calling us during this time. Lord, sweep away the thorns and the things that worry us and keep us from being ready to be the people that you would have us to be. Help us to be a people that can learn and grow and find new ways of being your church, of being your sons and daughters, of being your mission and your kingdom in this world. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
Praise be the nurses and doctors, every medical staff bent over flesh to offer care, for lives saved and lives lost, for showing up either way. Praise for the farmers tilling soil, planting seeds so food can grow, an act of hope if ever there was. Praise be the janitors and garbage collectors, the grocery store clerks and the truck drivers barreling through long, quiet nights. Give thanks for bus drivers, delivery persons, postal workers, and all those keeping an eye on water, gas, and electricity. Blessings on our leaders making hard choices for the common good, offering words of assurance. Celebrate the scientists working a way to understand the thing that plagues us, to find an antidote, and all the medicine makers. Praise be the journalists keeping us informed. Praise be the teachers, finding new ways to educate children from afar, and blessings on parents holding it together for them. Blessed are the elderly and those with weakened immune systems, all those who worry for their health. Praise for those who stay at home to protect them. Blessed are the domestic violence victims on lockdown with abusers, the homeless and refugees. Praise for the artists and poets, the singers and storytellers, all those who nourish with words and sound and color. Blessed are the ministers and therapists of every kind, bringing words of comfort. Blessed are the ones whose jobs are lost, who have no savings, who feel fear of the unknown gnawing. Blessed are those in grief, especially who mourn alone. Blessed are those who have passed into the great night. prays for police and firefighters, paramedics, and all who work to keep us safe. Prays for all the workers and caregivers of every kind. Prays for the sound of notifications, messages from friends reaching across the distance. Give thanks for laughter and kindness. Praise be our four-footed companions with no forethought or anxiety, responding only in love. Praise for the seas and rivers, forests and stones who teach us to endure. Give thanks for your ancestors, for the wars and plagues they endured and survived. Their resilience is in your bones, your blood. Blessed is the water that flows over our hands and the soap that helps keep them clean. Each time a baptism. Praise every moment of stillness and silence so new voices can be heard. Praise the chance at slowness. Praise be the birds who continue to sing the sky awake each day. Praise for the primrose poking yellow petals from dark earth. Blessed is the air clearing overhead so one day we can breathe deeply again. And when this has passed, may we say that love spread more quickly than any virus ever could. May we say this was not just an ending, but also a place to begin.
My friends, we know that change is hard, but God is always with us, even in the midst of this. For those of you who are going back to school tomorrow, know that you are in our prayers, whether you're students or teachers or administrators. We know that you are stressed and that tomorrow will be a difficult day, and we are praying for you. But even in the midst of this, God uses change to help us grow and thrive and learn, and we are never more available for those things than in times just like this. So go with God into the world to come this week. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.